What's going on, man? This is Let's Be Frank, man. My brother, my brother, my brother. Truth as I know it, man. I'm making you this private video, man. You kicked my ass this morning, brother, with that video. But before I get off into that, let me begin by saying, brother, I sent you that PayPal, man, so you can continue your work, my brother. Because the only way the manosphere, the brothers in the manosphere, the brothers of this awakening will keep this alive is just not through their participation, but through their financial participation as well. So brother, take that, and as I get more, I'm going to send you what I can. Go ahead, shout your brother out so that these other brothers will have a name to know that, hey, that monetary faith is being put behind your message.
Came across this study in the Science Advances Journal. It's titled The Population Prevalence of Solitary Confinement. And I'm going to read you the abstract and the introduction, and then we're going to break it down. We'll have a conversation about this. And it says, solitary confinement is a severe form of incarceration closely associated with long-lasting psychological harm and poor post-release outcomes. Estimating the population prevalence, we find that 11% of all black men in Pennsylvania born in 1986 to 1989 were incarcerated in solitary confinement by age 32. Let me read that again, because although it's not surprising, that's still shocking. It says again, estimating the population prevalence, we find that 11% of all black men in Pennsylvania, born in 1986 to 1989, were incarcerated in solitary confinement by age 32. Reflecting large racial disparities, the population prevalence is only 3.4% for Latinos and 1.4% for white men. About 9% of black men in the state cohort were held in solitary confinement more than 15 consecutive days, violating the United Nations standards for minimum treatment of incarcerated people. Nearly 1 in 100 black men experienced solitary for a year or longer by age 32. Racial disparities are similar for women, but rates are lower. A decomposition shows that black men's high risk of solitary confinement stems primarily from their high imprisonment rate. Findings suggest that harsh conditions of U.S. incarceration have population-level effects on black men's well-being. Now, in the introduction, it goes on and it says, black men in the United States are imprisoned at disproportionately high rates. As the U.S. incarceration rate grew historically high levels in the early 2000s, this disparity has resulted in population-level effects. Data from the 1970s to the 2000s indicate that 20 to 30% of black men have been to prison by their mid-30s. Although period prevalence estimates describe the broad extent of incarceration, they convey little about prison conditions or racial disparities in the severity of incarceration. If you want to read this article, I'll just pin a link in the top of the comments so you can go ahead and read that. It's a very shocking statistic that in a three-year window in the state of Pennsylvania, 11% of all black men were in solitary confinement by the age of 32.
That's fucking crazy.
That's cruel. It's inhumane. And it's a crime against humanity. And I want to talk about this issue but from a different perspective. Because we're in a new era. We're in the George Floyd COVID era. And being in a new era means having access to new information, a way to look at things in ways that we never looked at them before. And I think when it comes to the biological concept of race, it's important that black men and black women understand that, understand this, but also the rest of the world, every other American needs to understand this, that the biological concept of race, this idea, this science of racial biology where you have a black race and a white race and maybe even have a Asian race and mixed races, that this idea of race is a prison. It's a psychological prison. It's a political prison. It's a social prison. It's a cultural prison. And this biological concept of race, the way we know it, it houses first and foremost black men. This is why in the article they said 11%, over 1 in 10 black men born in the state of Pennsylvania between 1986 and 1989, that 11% were put in solitary confinement. And I know this is hard for people to understand at first. It's hard to accept at first. But once you see it, you can't unsee it. And you go, oh, I see it now. And what I'm trying to communicate is that the biological concept of race itself, this idea that we are black people living amongst white people, is a manufactured social political invention to divide and conquer, to split people up and split resources in a way that it helps white people and hurts non-white people and definitely hurts black people. And that this biological concept of race was invented by demented white supremacist scientists and people in law, in government, so they can control the masses. Because there was a time in America where you didn't have black people and white people. You had French Europeans, you had German Europeans, you had English Europeans, you had Irish Europeans, you had Africans from different countries, from different tribes, you had different people from their homelands would come to America. In America, you used to have free black people, free Africans, and free Europeans living side by side, getting married during slavery, before the biological concept of race was codified into law. Well, they had to create a cultural structure, a political structure, to normalize an economy built upon human slavery. And that's what the biological concept of race is. It's nothing more than idea that we're going to divide people and oppress people based off of skin color. And you create a hierarchy and you say white people are on top and black people are on the bottom. And then we're going to attach meanings. White is good and everything. The white people are good and black people are bad. And therefore now, because we can do that, black people are, they can't learn, they're violent, they're subhuman. So it only makes sense to put them in chains and work them like farm equipment because they're our slaves and they're below us. So we're supposed to do this. So they developed this idea of biological races to normalize and ease the cognitive dissonance of having an economy built on human slavery. Now that was so far in the past that many of us today cannot fathom that the concept of race is a scientific fraud. The biological concept of race is a pseudoscience. Yet in the black community, you won't hear very many black people dive into this issue the way it needs to be. Now, why is that important? Why should we even talk about this? See, I'm not crazy. I'm not crazy for saying this. I'm truthful. I'm accurate. What I'm saying is 100% factual. What it is that you're crazy for living in this white supremacist paradigm called race, which is the biological concept of race, and out of this fraudulent pseudoscience called the biological concept of race comes the isms of race. Out of that comes racism, the isms of race. So then we look and we go, no, that's not what it is. They're black, we're white, we're black, they're white. That's just the way it is. And it's like, no, that's not just the way it is. Somebody concocted this wild idea that everybody from the continent of Africa is all one demographic called black. And everybody else from the continent of Europe is all one demographic called white. Just look at their skin, and they're all one and the same. We look at that as normal. We don't look at that as white supremacy, and that's a problem, because it is white supremacy. There's nothing more white supremacy than the concept of race. That's the cornerstone foundation of racism, is the concept of race. Now you're gonna hear that, you go, well, I've never heard that before. If that was true, how come more people aren't talking about that? Well, people do talk about that. They have books about it. The Human Genome Project proved in the year 2000 that the biological concept of race is a pseudoscience. Overwhelmingly, the biological life sciences will tell you the concept of race isn't real. And those that do try to tell you that are real, it's always white supremacists who want to keep the social hierarchy and the usury of black people intact. And this is a problem, because as black men in the black manosphere, we talk about the gynocracy, we talk about the matriarchy, we talk about the black family structure. And the Roger Report did a masterful job of saying this, that a lot of women in the black community see black men through the lens of white supremacy. This is why a lot of black women reject intact families and marriages with black men, because they see black men in the very same way that white people and racist white people see black men. Because that's what being a black man is when it comes to race. Race isn't biological. Race is social, it's political, it's cultural, it's not biological. And if you really think about it, it's absurd. The concept of race is kind of silly when you just a cursory examination, where Africans, like the continent of Africa, people on the continent of Africa have more genetic diversity than all other demographics of people combined. Think about that. People on the continent of Africa, Africans have the most genetic diversity than all other demographics of people combined. That's a genetic fact. So how are all black people one and the same? How are African American slave descendants like myself, how am I the same as an African in East Africa, in Ethiopia? How are we one and the same? I don't see how that works out, that we're one and the same. As a matter of fact, what they had to do is say, oh no, there's nothing. You had to take away the biology to make people black. You had to take away people's biology and just ignore their biology. Ignore the DNA. No, we're gonna ignore that. You're just white. Just look at your skin color. That's all it takes. And even then, it's very arbitrary, because you have some black people that can pass as white. You have some white people that don't really know that they're white and that they're mixed, and they are. They're like, no, I'm white. And it's like, oh, you took a DNA test, or, you know, your dad wasn't your dad. You're actually mixed. There's nothing really genetic about race at all. And it's important to understand this, because the biological concept of race hurts black men more than anybody else. And this, to me, this is just something that kind of gets glossed over in these type of conversations. Nobody ever says, we should just outlaw, we should get rid of this normalization of this idea of biological races. Much in the same way where we see in this modern era, in this new modern era that we're in this George Floyd era, where we see that the left wing, that out of the left wing, we see people trying to get rid of gender pronouns. They go, we need to get rid of gender pronouns, all, you know, within the language and the way we speak. You know, like the Disneyland just had a meeting, and somebody recorded the meeting. I think that it's real. I'm not sure that it's real, but I think it's real. And in the meeting, they said, we're not going to say, boys and girls, welcome to Disneyland. They're going to say something like, welcome people of all ages to Disneyland. And they're just going to change the language so it's not so gendered. So we take this huge emphasis off gender in America. Well, I can see why people are doing that, and I understand the criticisms on why people kind of see it silly, and there's pushback to that. But that's not, I'm really indifferent to that myself, and that's not really, I'm not bringing it up for that issue, but I just want to make a comparison that, and ask the question that, shouldn't we do that with the biological concept of race? If the whole point of being a black person is, the whole social invention of being a black man is to be the number one target of America's hostility and this brutal prisons and jail system, then how does it serve black men and African and slave descendants to keep a hold of this idea that we are black people in a former white supremacist human slave colony? What good is it to attach ourselves to this idea of blackness as if it's ours forever? Because it's quite clear to me that blackness, this idea that we are black people, was never ours to keep in the first place. It was given to us. We had our indigenous culture, our language, just stripped from us, our family structures ripped apart, and blackness was forced upon us by law and fear and threat of death and violence. And then out of that, we fought and scratched and clawed our way out of slavery. And even in during the Jim Crow era, you still had these brutal forms of white supremacy punishing the African-American community. And this concept of pro-blackness was born as a defense mechanism against white supremacy. I'm black and I'm proud. I'm black and I'm proud. I'm a man. So pro-blackness is a defense mechanism against white supremacy. It was a very necessary component. It's a beautiful component. It's something to be cherished and respected, but I'm not sure that it's something to be held on to forever, because the paradigm that it comes from is a paradigm that we want to leave in the past. How do you keep race and get rid of racism? Racism, what's the root word? What's the root word of racism? Race. You got a black race, you got a white race, and we pretend there's other races, but there really isn't. There's only really one race. It's the white race versus non-white race in the system of white supremacy. And then we can say there's the black race and there's mongoloid races, and, you know, and we can pretend that there's really, really more than one, when really there's just one race. It's two races, white and non-white. So why are we still clinging on to blackness as if it was ours to keep forever? I think we need a whole new paradigm that we classify ourselves under. how we aggregate ourselves together. We were known as black, Negro, colored. We've been a lot of different things. And it's always evolved because the era has evolved. Well, now we're in a new era. It's time for a new way to relate to one another. All this real nigga, you know, I'm pro-black, but yet I struggle to get a wife who loves me and who and wants to have an intact family simply because you're a black man. Your own women reject you because they have had that biological concept of race. They've been immersed in this culture where now they, a lot of women look at their own men through the lens of white supremacy because you're a black man. I think more people need to have this conversation. This is an idea. This is a concept. I don't necessarily want you to believe what I'm saying. As much as I do, I want you to understand what I'm saying. Even if you disagree, you might say, man, truth is on some bullshit with this. Man, what's he talking about, man? He talking that silly willy stuff. Man, what's he on, man? Come on. And I get that because it sounds out of left field. It's a very radical idea for some. I don't consider it radical at all. To me, this is really what mainstream groupthink should be. And I think that people who don't really have this mentality or actually struggle to accept this truth, this very obvious truth, to me it looks like that maybe they have a more of a conservative frame of mind. And when you have a conservative frame of mind, it's like you look at that window and you got this window frame, right? And you just want to keep looking at through that same window frame, and you don't want to look at another window frame. So you kind of have this conservative frame of mind. But when you have a progressive frame of mind, you'll look at that one window and you might like it and you might not. And then you say, well, I'm willing to tear out this frame. I'm really willing to tear out this window frame and build a new one, a better one, so I can have a better perspective on this world. And out of this better perspective, we can start to derive better outcomes. We can get better outcomes by really digging into this idea and creating a new paradigm where the biological concept of race is no longer respected. It's no longer seen as a social norm. I mean, how sick do you have to be to have where the state of Pennsylvania even has the possibility, has the apparatus, has a superstructure that has the ability to house 11% of all black men in Pennsylvania in a 3-year period in solitary confinement. The ability to even do that proves that white people are themselves suffering from this racial prison. It's not just black people, it's white people too. And this is partly why this country has so many problems, because we cling on to this biological concept of race as if it's normal and benign and just how we divide each other. It's not that serious truth, you know? Like, it just would make sense. You organize each other because the first thing you see is the skin tone difference, so it just makes sense that we would do that. And usually this is the pushback that you hear from people who've really never contemplated or read about this subject. And so it's a response that you hear because people have been miseducated. Because when you really start to look at the history of the concept of race, you start to see that it was birthed out of slavery. It was literally birthed out of slavery to normalize the institution in the minds of white people. And this is why there's so many negative attachments to black people from a scientific standpoint. For instance, during the slave days, they said you had drapetomania, which meant that if you ran off the slave plantation, that you had some sort of mental illness. Or they had a lot of different diseases. One of them was called something like a chameleon, or, you know, and they said if you have if the slave's kids start looking like the slave master, well, that's just because it's natural, because, you know, they kind of grow up, you know, you live next to one another, you look like one another. So that's what it is. It was called Symbiosis was the name of it. It was Symbiosis. So you have to understand that this concept of race is slave culture. It's the foundation, it's the very foundation of white supremacy and slave culture. Yet here we are in 2022, and black people, white people, Asian people, we still use these slave terms to describe ourselves as if it's not sick-minded, which it is. As a black man, I think you understand very clearly that to be classified as black and male in this former white supremacist slave colony is going to get you undue punishment, hostility, and anger from the people around you, because that's what the culture informs people. And I think as black men, we should free ourselves from this prison. Why should we be locked into a prison when we have the ability to leave by destroying this concept of race as something that is normalized? Our own women reject us because of the biological concept of race, because they believe it in a similar way that white supremacists believe it. So they look at you as less than and inferior. And if I'm going to get with you, then you're going to have to make six figures, and you're going to have movie star looks and be 6'5" and repping 225 at least 15 times minimum. So what's the point of clinging on to a concept that was created, designed, and maintained to destroy you? I'll wait. Why are we so attached to this idea that we're all black when the idea of blackness was invented to destroy us? This is just food for thought. I just want you to contemplate this idea and this concept of the biological concept of race being racism, being white supremacy itself. Racism is merely the isms of race. So why should we keep race if it's going to create racism and work against black men?